I got to start on the supply chain issues. Given your experience and many years at Samsung, what's your take on the challenges that's facing, you know, just about everyone here, and how bad this is compared to anything you've seen prior in your career?
This is pretty a difficult case. I think pandemic really made it much worse than it should be. And you know, one of the things that happened in our industry is all about just-in-time delivery, which is a really very efficient way of running your business with minimum inventory. When it worked great. During the pandemic, we have different issues, different factories, different products, different countries. They all have different shutdown programs, and we really lost our signal. And when you lose your signal, it's hard to regain that message. And as you know, today, electronics are not just a one part that what we build today. If you look at automobiles, there are 1,300 components, and if you have one piece missing, you are going to have supply disruptions. But this is interdependency and complexity we are living in. So the pandemic really hurt us. And on the top of that, the demand for IT products really went up. You know, we all have home offices. We all need more cloud and mobility information that helped increase IT spending, which doesn't help this whole issues of the supply chain topics. On the top of that, also semiconductor perspective, as we're discussing this, typically it takes 2 to 3 years to build capacity, and there were underinvestment as well as the freezing investment for a while, which doesn't help this whole industrial issues.
Right. You wonder if, you know, our expectations have simply just gotten too high with this just-in-time delivery that we're all now so used to. Apple might have to cut production of 10 million iPhones right ahead of the holidays. I imagine Samsung is dealing with stuff, a lot of these issues behind the scenes as well. Can you give us a picture of what's happening, you know, on the back end of these companies, just trying to make things, get things together in time for the holidays?
So I can give you two perspectives. Samsung is a component supplier, Samsung is a system maker, Harman is a company that are actually building auto and audio products that goes into these products. And basically, if you look at end product perspective, Harman, for instance, they are supplying systems that goes into automobiles, and every day this is a race trying to get the part, expediting, substituting product. And our customers are trying to change their SKU mix so that they can be able to ship their products, typically, which means less volume, but higher premium products. That can go on for a while, but I think eventually it's going to catch up. On the side of component supply in Samsung, which is the largest semiconductor company, they are doing everything they can. In fact, we announced $200 billion investment decision in semiconductor. But as I told you, it takes time. It takes time to build things. It takes time to assemble teams. And in this process, I think it's creating a difficult scenario. So everybody's really working hard. Everybody's trying to accelerate it. But also issues that there is a shipment issues. If you look at the some of the disruption that are going on in terms of the shipping, the unloading products, all those things are requiring also a lot of disruptions as well.
Let's talk about your fund then. More than $500 million to invest in early stage deep tech startups. So we're talking about big data. We're talking about AI, chips, cloud, digital biology. What are your big goals here, especially in light of what we're seeing the world needs right now?
You know, I think that when we say deep tech, it's an area that we actually don't recognize the importance as much as we used to. And if you think about the way we send the people to the moon, and other defense-related spendings that helped us create new technologies. The vaccines that we all use today that are developed within a year, mRNA, would not have been possible without DARPA spending, without deep fund spending that are ahead of its curve. So I think it's really important we think long-term, and I believe that we have to use science and the disruption and market opportunities to make an impact, and that's what Deep Tech Fund is about. We think the data infrastructure, data requirements are doubling every 2 years. And the truth is the current architecture, the network, the software, and operating system have to improve. And that's an opportunity for people like us.
There are a lot of concerns around data privacy and ethical AI. You're seeing the battle between Apple and Facebook or Meta over our own data. And I'm wondering if there's any concern that not gathering enough data or not gathering more data could slow the advancement of AI down.
You know, I think that there are two different issues, right? Technology is not good or bad, it's how we use it. And I think the more data around our body can give you a lot more knowledge about our health. They can give us a better proactive diagnostic rather than reactive care that we see today, which can reduce healthcare costs. So that's a clear example of data that can give you better insight. Autonomous driving could be an example of how we can save lives. But then how we use the data, they can be able to balance the need and advancement of our need, as well as being able to deploy in an ethical way. And data is not about, data is around the bias issues that we have to create. So we need to make sure data is not biased. We need to make sure data is used properly. So these are some of the things that we have to think through, and we have an opportunity to work on this.
Last quick question, Young. You were on the board of ARM previously, and I'm curious if you think NVIDIA is going to get this deal done and if you think it's a good idea in the end.
You know, I think there are two different issues. There are geopolitical tensions that are increasing. And if you think about it in the perspective of Europe, perspective of China and U.S., ARM is an architecture for all mobile products that we use today. Every mobile phone virtually uses ARM-based architecture and processor. So I think there is a lot of attention around who controls this type of architecture in which geographic region, which is going to create a race condition. China clearly is not going to be something that will continue to depend on U.S. companies, vice versa. So I believe this geotension will increase, and we need to be mindful of those. I also think the new architecture will come. The ARM architecture has been around the last 30 years. RISC-V is coming, maybe something else will come. So the investment in deep tech, the looking at new architecture, they can be able to reduce power and they can be able to give you a new footprint will accelerate.